I think we need to start from schwannoma, right? This myocardial infarction we had covered in the earlier class. So schwannoma. Okay. Without delay, can anyone describe this? We need to finish this slides today. There are, I think, 7 or 8 slides, so we'll try to finish. Anyone, please describe this. This has been taught in the class, right? In the practical?
No, sir.
No. Okay, then. This is a schwannoma, a peripheral. This will be a picture of benign peripheral nerve sheath tumor, which encompasses neurofibroma and schwannoma. Both will have proliferation of neural cells, but here you will get. I know that in the lecture it has been covered, and you need to know that. So, anyone, can you tell what are the features of schwannoma? Not yet taught, right? Yes or no?
No, sir, it hasn't been
No, sir.
covered, sir.
Okay. Then we'll leave it for now. Okay. We'll leave it for now. It won't come in the exam also. It has not been taught in the theory also. It won't come. Just it was in your list, so I incorporated it there. Okay. Slide number 28. Please describe this. Fast. This is a biopsy from the skin. This is the biopsy from a skin in a patient who has a leonine face. So this is enough, actually. This is enough. In the patient has a leonine face with nodular lesion on the face, ears, and the elbows. So what is the diagnosis? For this is very easy. You don't have to see the slide even. But always you have to see the slide for confirmation. So what is the diagnosis? And give two identification points to support your diagnosis. So here, diagnosis is lepromatous leprosy. Here we can see there is diffuse proliferation of there is histiocytes and macrophages, foam cells. Yes. These are all foam cells. Yes. And what is this? This clear space?
Grain zone.
Grain zone. Okay. Clear grain zone is also there. Okay. That is peculiar of lepromatous leprosy. And there is a minimal amount of lymphocytic infiltration are also seen, not that as much as we seen in the tuberculoid type of leprosy. Why that? Why the
No,
infarction?
sir.
Okay, very good, very good. Immunity is depressed in case of lepromatous leprosy. Therefore, the inflammatory cell will also be low. So here, what is the causative organism?
Mycobacterium
Lepre. Okay. This is the section skin with epidermis and dermis. Dermis shows sheets of foamy macrophages. A band of collagen is seen between the epidermis and dermis, which is the grain zone. And especially stains show presence of numerous bright pink rod-like structures of Mycobacterium lepre. If we do the special stain, okay, then we can see Mycobacterium lepra bacilli can be seen. So that is it. So the next spectrum of leprosy. Can anyone describe this? So here a history is a patient presented with a patch in the arm which has hypoesthesia and an enlarged ulnar nerve of the same side. A patient present with patch in the arm which has hypoesthesia. Hypoesthesia means?
Loss of senses.
Okay, it is not loss of senses. Loss of sensation is anesthesia. Okay, hypoesthesia means decrease in sensation. And an enlarged ulnar nerve. There is enlargement of the nerve of the same side. So biopsy has been taken from that lesion. What is this? Here you can see there are multiple granulomas, right? Yes, here you can see the multinucleated giant cell, Langhan type. Can you appreciate it or not? Can you see this?
Yes, sir.
Okay, this and these are also these elongated things. They are all epithelioid cells, which are the transformed histiocytes. There are presence of what is this? Multinucleated giant cell, not only giant cell, multinucleated giant cell. Okay, so this is a granulomatous condition. We know that, along with some inflammatory cells, chronic inflammatory cells, and these granulomas, they are tending to erode the basal layer of the epidermis, which is the feature of tuberculoid leprosy. There is no green zone. Yes. Are you understanding this or not?
Yes.
Okay. If you can see here in the leprosomatous leprosy, there is a clear space between the epidermis and the lesion, throughout the lesion. But here you don't see that clear space. So these granulomas are trying to erode the basal layer of the epidermis There is presence of granulomas with epithelioid cells and multinucleated giant cells, lymphocytes are there, and there will be eroding encroachment of the nerves and other superficial nerves will be there, and adnexal structures like hair follicles, sebaceous glands and all these, they will also be encroaching towards them pilorector muscle. So they will be in these granulomas will be encroaching towards them, mostly towards the nerves. So that is the feature of tuberculoid leprosy. So what is the organism responsible for this lesion?
Mycobacterium
leprae. Okay. What specialization do you perform for this organism? Jill Nelson. Okay, Jill Nelson stain with some change in concentration of the acid, right? So what will be the concentration?
5%.
It is 20% for the Mycobacterium tuberculosis bacilli, whereas for the leprae bacilli, we use 5%. It is less acid fast. So we don't have to go through this again. Okay. This is a very easy slide. So any one of you, can you please describe this? Sorry, I couldn't hear. Can you repeat it, please?
We see seeds and cords of malignant keratin cells pulse. With keratin pulse.
Okay, these are all keratin pulse. There is seeds and cords of malignant cells along with multiple keratin pulse. So what is the diagnosis?
small squamous cell carcinoma.
Okay, very good. Squamous cell carcinoma. You know all the things, just you have to push yourself to make yourself talk. A 50-year-old male present with a large ulcerative proliferative growth over the foot, a biopsy from the lesion was taken. What is the diagnosis? Squamous cell carcinoma. Mention three other sites where this tumor can occur. That means mention other sites where you can see the squamous cell carcinoma. So what are these?
Skin, esophagus, oral cavity.
Okay, very good. I think skin, this is fair enough. Okay, but cervix, you can get that in cervix, anal canal, penis, and all these areas also. Okay. Okay. The sections from the tumor show seeds and cords of malignant squamous cells. These malignant cells show eosinophilic cytoplasm and vesicular nuclei with prominent nucleoli, and malignant keratin pulse are also seen at places. So this is what you have to write. Any problem with this slide?
No,
okay, then we'll move ahead. Okay, anyone? The history is 60 years old male patient had a small non-healing growth in the nasal bridge. So it is in the nasal area. It bleeds and torts. So the biopsy from that lesion has been given. So what is this? Can you please describe?
Malignant
cell carcinoma. Okay, Shreya, please carry on.
And the section shows clusters of basaloid cells that extending from the undersurface of epidermis.
Okay, very good.
And there is peripheral palisading.
Okay, here you are seeing these are all areas of peripheral palisading and rest.
There is a cleft between the group of tumor cells and the surrounding stroma.
Very good. Very good. That is enough. That is enough for a basal cell carcinoma. Okay. So what is the diagnosis? It is basal cell carcinoma. Give two identification points you have given. Here you can see proliferation of the basaloid cells. That's why it is known as basal cell carcinoma. Basaloid cells, dark basaloid cells are there in nest. And irregular nest and cords are also there. And within this nest, there is peripheral palisading of the tumor cells when they go towards the periphery. And there is a clefting between the tumor cell nest and the stroma. So this is a basal cell carcinoma. Can someone tell what is the gross feature of this basal cell carcinoma? Very good, poorly papules. But later on, if it is a very old lesion, what can happen?
Bleeding. And become translucent borders.
Okay, what else?
We may see swollen blood vessels, telangiectasia.
Okay, telangiectated blood vessels we can see. Yes, very good. Very good. What else?
Sir, extensive local invasion.
Okay, there will be local invasion. Okay, that is also seen. It is, the metastasis is not that common, but local invasion can be seen. What else?
Pigmentation.
Okay, pigmented basal cell carcinoma can be there. What do you mean a rodent ulcer?
Sir, it makes a tunnel-like structure as it invades.
Okay, what in which lesion that is seen?
Sir, in basal cell carcinoma.
Okay. So you have to tell that. Okay, although that doesn't come in microscopy, but you have to know that. All right. So we have already talked about these things. So now we'll move to this one, 32nd slide. Can anyone please describe this?
There are nests of tumor cells in the dermis of the skin.
Okay, very good.
And some tumor cells are also seen in the epidermis layer.
In the epidermis layer, okay.
The tumor cells have melanin, brown-colored melanin pigment.
Okay, they have the brown color granular melanin pigment. Okay. One thing you told that there are multiple tumor cells in nests, right?
Yes, sir.
And singly also. Here you can see singly also you can see. And how are these tumor cells? Can you describe these tumor cells? One is melanin pigment. They contain melanin pigment that you have told. Others?
They have large nuclei, cum chromatin.
Okay. Okay, Shreya, before you, someone was speaking. Who was that?
Can
you
please?
Yes, Suman. Suman, please talk.
The nucleus. Hyperchromatic nucleus.
Very good. Hyperchromatic nuclei will be there. The cells will be highly pleomorphic, right? So, Suman, what do you mean by pleomorphism?
Variation in size and shape of cells in a tissue.
Okay, very good. So here there will be pleomorphism. The cells will have all the features of atypia. Like there will be pleomorphism. They will have high ANSI ratio. They will have hyperchromatic nuclei. And they will have invasion. And some tumor cells are seen in the epidermis, whereas some are seen in nest and singly scattered in the epidermis, which are infiltrating into the epidermis. So what are the phases of malignant melanoma?
Lentigo-maligna melanoma, superficial spreading, acral, lentiginous, and nodular melanoma.
Okay, you talked about superficial spreading. Okay, this you talked about types of melanoma. Okay, these are all the types of melanoma. What are the stages of melanoma? First, it will be superficial spreading type. Yes, it can remain in superficial spreading phase for many years, and you don't know when it will invade, and it will have a invasive stage. Yes. Is that correct?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Then here the section shows nest of malignant tumor cells in the dermis, and rest of the things we have already described about the malignant melanin pigment also we have described. But you should know about the phases and types of malignant melanoma. You should know something more about malignant melanoma in the tumors of the skin, about the squamous cell carcinoma, basal cell carcinoma, and malignant melanoma. These three tumors are very important. These things you should know in detail. Okay, whatever is given in Robbins or Harshmohan. Okay, this one. Can anyone describe?
Lacy unmineralized matrix.
Okay, there is lacy unmineralized matrix. So that is matrix of?
Osteoid.
Osteoid. Okay. Okay, very good. That is the first impression. Then rest.
Tumor cells show atypia.
Sorry? Tumor cells show atypia. Okay, very good. So, well, what will be the characteristics of these tumor cells?
High NC ratio.
Okay. So basically, yes, pleomorphism, hyperchromatic nuclei or vesicular nuclei with presence of nucleoli, high NC ratio. This is common for almost all the tumors. These are the, except some tumors like renal cell carcinoma, where you can have a low NC ratio, okay, where you can have a abundant cytoplasm. Otherwise, the features of atypia is almost similar for all the tumors. But we should see what is the degree of the differentiation we need to see, like in squamous cell carcinoma, moderately differentiated or well differentiated or poorly differentiated, that we need to see. And we need to see the grade of the tumor, whether the tumor cells are of low grade or high grade, that we need to see. Okay, here we can see whatever you have, what you have told is very correct. Here we can see tumor cells which are showing all the features of atypia. They have high NC ratio, they show pleomorphism with hyperchromatic to vesicular nuclear chromatin, and they have presence of nucleoli. They are somewhat spindled to elongated, yes, and they are directly producing this osteoid. Because this is a case of osteosarcoma. Osteosarcoma means this is a tumor of the malignant tumor with differentiation towards the bone. Yes? Or this is a bone tumor, primary bone tumor. Yes or no? This is a primary malignant bone tumor or not?
Yes, sir.
Okay, then?
Yes, sir.
Then these tumor cells are producing the osteoid. It will make a lacy matrix of osteoid. Here you can see the bone. Here you can see multinucleated giant cell, tumor giant cells also. These are the multinucleated tumor giant cells. So this is a osteosarcoma. So what are the, okay, here is the question. A 17-year-old boy presented with rapidly growing tumor near the left knee. So see the age, 17 year, see the site, tumor near the left knee, okay, and it is rapidly growing. So this rapidly growing, whenever it is given rapidly growing, then you should go towards a malignant side. And 17 year and the left knee, now it is the site for a osteosarcoma according to the site and the age. So write the diagnosis, mention two identification points. We have already talked about this. Mention the X-ray findings of this tumor.
Sunburst
appearance and
Codman's triangle.
Okay. So this production, there will be production of osteoid, which is an unmineralized bony matrix by the tumor cells, which are lacy with eosinophilic material. This you should know. Okay, then we'll move to 34th slide. Here the this is a biopsy taken from a 20-year-old female patient who came with a swelling near her left knee. So this is taken from the bone near the knee. So what is the diagnosis? And mention two points of identification. So with this history and the biopsy from the knee area, so what is this? See the slide and describe this. Anyone, please describe.
Sir, it's a giant cell tumor and the section shows sheets of uniform mononuclear oval malignant cells.
Okay. So it is a giant cell tumor of the bone. So there are uniform
mononuclear cell.
Sorry, there are uniform
mononuclear malignant cells.
Okay, before that. Okay, the name is giant cell tumor. That means there should be giant cells. Here you can see multiple giant cells, multiple multinucleated giant cells, numerous multinucleated giant cells, osteoclast like giant cells are there. Can you see this? Can you appreciate this?
Yes.
Okay. Those who are in this class in the through the mobile phones, can you see the slides?
Yes, sir.
Yes. Okay. Here you can see there are multiple osteoclast-like giant cells, and there are mononuclear cells in the background. There are mononuclear cells, and these nucleus of the multinuclear giant cells and that of the mononuclear cells, they are identical. Okay. So this is the feature of giant cell tumor. Mention two important X-ray features of this lesion.
Subbowel
appearance and
lytic lesion.
Okay, lytic lesion. There will be a lytic lesion and subbowel appearance. Okay, very good. So this we do not need to revise. Means we have already talked about this. The section show, we'll go through it fast. Section shows a series of uniform oval mononuclear cells with indistinct cell margin, and scattered in the background are numerous osteoclast-like giant cells. These giant cells may have 100 or more nuclei looking similar to mononuclear cells. Yes, and there is area of hemorrhage, necrosis, and reactive newborn formation also seen. So this is the final slide, but we have two slides remaining from the previous class, which was not taken in your main practical class. So we'll go through this. So this is, I'll just tell you, before exam, if you are here in the college, if you are present here in the college physically, we'll try to show you this Hodgkin lymphoma. And if you are not here, try to listen carefully. So a history will be, for example, a 44-year-old male presents with multiple generalized lymphadenopathy along with anemia. The lymph nodes were rubbery in consistency and they were matted. The person complained of rise of temperature, weakness, loss of weight, and appetite. So what is the characteristic cell of this condition is asked. Okay, so the slide is given. So now when a 44-year-old male here multiple generalized lymphadenopathy is there, and the lymph nodes are enlarged with generalized lymphadenopathy, and multiple is there, and the person is complaining of a rise of temperature, weakness, and loss of weight and appetite, then some malignant process should be going on. The other DD here will be a tubercular lymph node. But here, for that, you have to see there is no feature of KGS necrosis or granuloma, and there is presence of these Reed-Sternberg cells, RS cells, which have. Can you explain this particular Reed-Sternberg cell?
They form mirror images.
Okay, very good. Mirror image. They are binucleated. Okay, binucleated with a mirror image. Then
prominent nucleoli.
Very good. Prominent large macronucleoli, eosinophilic, which will be eosinophilic, and
the characteristic gives hourly appearance.
Hourly appearance, very good. And the nuclear rim will be thickened. Okay, this will give a all eye appearance. So this is a characteristic Reed-Sternberg cell, which is mandatory to diagnose a Hodgkin lymphoma. There will be other, there can be other things like in the background, there can be other T cells, other B cells can be there. There can be granulomas. There can be reactive state like a reactive lymphadenite like states can be there. But if you see presence of these Reed-Sternberg cells, which we have just described, then it is a Hodgkin lymphoma. And WHO has given five types of this lesion. This is the, earlier it was four types, now it is five types. Okay, what are the types, subtypes of Hodgkin lymphoma?
Nodular.
Okay, nodular sclerosis.
Mixed cellularity.
Mixed cellularity.
Lymphocyte predominant.
Okay, no, and lymphocyte predominant. Okay, so here you can see there will be presence of many eosinophils along with these Reed-Sternberg cells, RS cells in the short form. There are many Reed-Sternberg cells along with mononuclear atypical cells along with some other lymphoid cells, and there will be presence of eosinophils. And according to the, and these mononuclear, these Reed-Sternberg cells also, this is the classical variant. This is the classical variant, which can be seen mostly in the Hodgkin lymphoma. But there can be presence of mononuclear RS cells also. Okay, you are seeing my pointer? Are you seeing the pointer?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Then this is a mononuclear RS cell, where you can see the similar morphology, but there won't be a mirror image. There will be a single cell. And here you can see lacunar. Okay, here you can see a lacunar, which is seen mostly in, which is seen in the nodular sclerosis, lacunar variant of this RS cell. Here you can see a clear space, folded nuclei with clear space. So this is a lacunar variant of the RS cell. And here you can see L and H variant, lymphocytic and histiocytic variant, or lymphohistiocytic variant, which is seen in lymphocyte predominant mostly. Okay, so these are the variants of RS cells, which can be seen. Apart from these RS cells, there are other lymphoid cells which can be atypical or might be others, T cells and B cells. So these are the subtypes of the Hodgkin lymphoma: nodular sclerosis, mixed cellularity, lymphocyte rich, lymphocyte depletion, and lymphocyte predominance. Where we told that LNH variant or popcorn cells will be there. In lymphocyte depletion, there will be this you have to study, or this has been taught to you in the theory class. Here we are talking just about the practical aspect. So is this clear?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Then we'll move to the next or final slide, which is a dermoid cyst, or better than dermoid cyst, we shall call it a macrocystic teratoma. Okay. Can you please describe, try to describe, I know that this it has not been taught in the class or the practical. Can you try to describe this? So this is, the history is the female presented with right ovarian mass. So this is right ovarian mass, which is cystic. This is the slide from the ovarian cyst or ovarian lesion. Okay, ovarian mass. So here you can see this is the cystic area and this is the cyst wall. In the cyst wall, you can see it is lined by stratified squamous epithelium. This is the stratified squamous epithelium of the cyst. Okay, and the cyst cavity contains of loose woven keratin. Here you can see this is the fibrocollagenous cyst wall, which contains, this is the sebaceous gland, adipose tissue, these are muscles, fibrocollagenous tissue, blood vessels are there. Okay, and there can be presence of cartilage, there can be presence of bone, there can be presence of glands. It can be lined by respiratory epithelium, which is pseudostratified ciliated columnar epithelium. So this is a mature cystic teratoma. So what is the diagnosis? Anyone? Nitesh Kumar Das.
Yes, sir.
What is the diagnosis, Nitesh?
Dermoid cyst, sir.
Okay, dermoid cyst, or better to call it mature cystic teratoma. Okay, because pathologically we call it more. Dermoid cyst is also fine, right? But pathologically it's better to call it a mature cystic teratoma. Okay, if you write dermoid cyst, no one will cut your marks. So I'm just talking about better to. And what do you see in a dermoid cyst in a microscopy?
All the structure which is derived from ectoderm, endoderm, and mesoderms.
Very good. Very good. So we can see all the structures which are derived from all the three germinal layers, from the ectoderm, which we are seeing, okay, from the endoderm and the mesoderm, like skin adnexal things and any glands or these lining squamous cells, adipose tissue, and blood vessels, cartilage, bone, nerve, glial tissue even. Sometimes tooth can be there. Okay, it is also bony. These all things can be there. So what are the two common surface epithelial tumors arising from this organ? Sorry? Can you please repeat?
Sorry, squamous cell carcinoma.
We are talking about what are the two common surface epithelial tumors arising from this organ, means from the ovary. What are the two common surface epithelial tumors arising from ovary? So you know what surface epithelial tumors are, right? So anyone? Not squamous cell carcinoma. Yes. serous cystadenoma and mucinous cystadenoma. If this has not been taught to you, serous cystadenoma and mucinous cystadenoma. Has this been taught? No. Okay then, this is it for today. We have gone through this identification points. Sections of the ovary, so keratinized, stratified squamous epithelium with flakes of keratin, and underlying tissue, so sebaceous glands, sweat glands, muscle fibers, hair follicles, blood vessels, and cartilage. There can be anything, adipose tissue can be there, muscles can be there, glands can be there, anything can be there. All arising from all the three germinal layers. Anything can be there. So this is for today. So we have finished the gross portion and we have finished the slide portion today. I will upload this gross and slide portion tomorrow in the evening, and you go through this thoroughly. Because if the exam happens online or offline, even if you physically also, if you know these things, then it will be very easier for you to pass the exam. Any problem till now in the gross and the slide part? Is there any problem?
Sir.
Yes.
Which one is the tumor cell in osteoclastoma?
Osteoclastoma, the tumor cells are the mononuclear cells.
And how are the giant cells formed?
They are also the tumor cells, okay? They are also the tumor cells, but those are the architecture of the tumor cells which are arranged in giant cells. But the main tumor cells are the singly scattered mononuclear cells.
Okay, sir.
If someone asks you, then you have to tell that the mononuclear cells are the tumor cells.
Okay.
Anything else? Okay, then if you don't have any questions, then next Friday we'll come up with hematology, I think. Hematological practicals, and then we'll do the instruments. We'll try to cover up in two or three practicals, and then we'll finish this revision also. Okay, and if you have any problem with today's or any previous classes in gross and microscopy, just write it down, because tomorrow or today even I will be uploading the slides, these slides of gross and microscopy. Then you can go through it, and then if you have any problem, then write it down. You can message or we can discuss in the next class, next Friday, 2:30. I think it's 2:15. It will be 2:15 from the next week. Okay then.
Okay, sir.
Okay, thank you.